Do you remember the named theorems? That's what I asked last time for you to remember. We have to start. I try to follow, by the way, more or less the schedule that the program. And today we should start discussing main principles of Ramsey theory. And the theorems which I formulated last time serve as excellent illustrations, and I will have to refer to them since I have afternoon a little bit more time than scheduled originally, so I can spend now time for sort of a survey or review what we did last time. And for me, it will be important in order to refer to these results. So we'll do it in a moment. Let me first formulate one more theorem, which surprisingly no one asked about. So the topic of my talks is, in a sense, what is called ergodic Ramsey theory. That's exactly an area where number theory, combinatorics, and ergodic theory intertwine and mutually help each other. And why it is called Ramsey? What is about Ramsey? I didn't formulate any Ramsey theorem last time. So it's natural to try to connect to Ramsey. So that, I will do it right now. So Ramsey was a, actually, non-mathematician. He was partly interested in logic, but he was actually interested in economics, and he's most famous for his work in economics. But he, in one of his papers on logic, he had a lemma, which was overlooked. So it was around 1930, or even earlier. And so here is Ramsey. So let's make some notation first. Let N2 the set of all two-element subsets I hope the notation is clear. So we take all two-element subsets of N. And I stress that these are two-element subsets. So you may want to think of them as integer points below the diagonal. Right? So every such a point has two coordinates, and because it's below the diagonal, they are distinct. And that's the set we are interested in. So you take this set, then for any partition, n equal, no, n2 equal union of ci, there exists s in n, s infinite, such that s2, and so to make formulation easier, let me call it coloring, is monochromatic. Sometimes we would write chi is a Greek letter from which the word chromatic starts in Greek, okay? So any questions about formulation? So let's spend a minute or two on this theorem and why it is so important and whether this delivers the spirit of Ramsey theory. So we took structure of two-element subsets. That's the highly organized structure that we care about. We finitely partitioned it, or finitely colored it. And the claim is that one piece of this coloring still contains exactly the same structure. It's all two-element subsets. So in some vague way, there is set theoretical isomorphism between any two countable sets. And so you started with two element subsets of a countable set. This is N2. And you end up with monochromatic version of it. This is S2. Is the statement clear? So this, of course, corresponds to that spirit of Ramsey theory about which I was talking last time. So you have something highly organized, you finitely partition. One piece is still highly organized. The advantage of this theorem is that you got, unlike many, if not most, Ramsey theoretical theorems, that you get arbitrarily large finite organized structures. Here it's even better. Here you have an infinite S with all two element sets of the same color. So if you think about this coloring as symmetric coloring of the integer points, symmetric in order to identify symmetric points here to those, then you end up with similar lattice. Think of this as a lattice, and this is what S2, and you get, again, something with exactly the same structure. Any questions? There are many questions you can start asking already here. Yes, please.
Is it true with the half of it without the symmetry?
No, but it's your, depends how you want to interpret it. Either you interpret N2 as all points below the diagonal, or you interpret it as points with identification. So take points above the diagonal, identify them with their symmetries. That's all the same. It's up to you. Yes?
Is that
constructive? Yeah. It's actually, there is more than one proof. You can find it in any place. You can even do it yourself. It's an extended pigeonhole principle, in a way. Okay, so that's the theorem of Ramsey. Now, it was rediscovered by Erdos and Szekeres with the help of Esther Klein. So theorem that they arrived at, I will tell you about now because it's curious application, you would not expect it. So Ramsey theorem turns out to be one of the most applicable things. If you go to internet and try to look for applications of Ramsey's theorem, you will see plenty. And I will suggest a few of them right now. But historically, it was Esther Klein, it was young Hungarian mathematicians eager to do mathematics and having good time getting together and asking questions and solving them. And so Esther Klein, they were all below 25 years old, and so she suggested the following question. Is it true that for any 5 points in general position in R2, 4 of them form a convex polygon? Okay, so suppose you have 5 points. This is primitive picture because they're already convex polygon, but of course these 4 form a convex polygon. And then it's easy to see, and that's actually the proof for this special case, that what are possible positions of 5 points in the plane? And in each time, there are practically very few options. This is another one, and here is this polygon. And it would be maybe another one. And here is again this polygon. So this is the proof. So for any 5 points in the plane, 4 of them form convex polygon. Where is Ramsey here? That's your exercise. But the general result of this kind is that, so general theorem, Erdos and Szekeres. So for any n, there exist C such that any set of points S in R2 in general position contains a convex polygon with n vertices. Here, S bigger than C. Any questions? So that's the spirit of such theorems. You have it for 5 points, and then when you take, 9 points, then it will be polygon on 5 vertices. But the asymptotics of the finite elements of here. So this C depends on N. How this C is growing, that's a typical question which Erdos liked to ask. And there are some results about this which are, as often happens, far away from being optimal. Okay? So dependence on C on N, that's still not totally solved question. What is less clear to you, and that's why I want to challenge you and to give it as an exercise, and it's quite okay if you go to internet, because these are so famous theorems, you will find it there. So how to prove this result? By using Ramsey's theorem. And of course, Ramsey's theorem has finitistic version, which could be enough for you. We can just speculate on this. But I hope it's clear how to formulate finitistic version. This is a topic which we should keep coming to. So this is infinitary Ramsey theorem. I like infinitary results because it's less quantifiers, and I personally care less about bounds. But getting bounds is a very important topic in number theory and combinatorics. I just will neglect it, partly because ergodic theory deals better with ideal objects and shows the way to next already more finitistic results. But the moment you have any result of this kind, there is immediately a possibility to ask finitistic question. Erdos was very good at that, not only because he was interested in this, but because he would make sometimes very precise predictions of log-logish nature, what is exactly there. So I hope we can, as an exercise, let's practice formulating it now in finitary terms, and I hope it's clear how. If you fix the size of this S in advance, and then, so S will be now finite. And instead of N, I will take just very large set. And then, depending on size of S, it will be a size of N, and depending on R, that you also fix. You see, immediately we have too many quantifiers, and that's why it's less attractive, but this is more powerful sometimes. So let me repeat. You fix R, you fix size of S. Then if this N2 is replaced by just all two elements of sets of very large set, the largeness of that set depends on R and cardinality of S. You will get the same result. Okay? Do I have to repeat it, or we get the spirit of it? We will be formulating finitistic versions of some other theorems, including van der Waerden and Szemeredi. So that's next thing for us potentially to do. Any questions? So here is then another application for you of Ramsey's theorem. So, and that's actually very useful in many situations. Oh, by the way, so this theorem, and that's how you will easier find it on the internet, it's called sometimes happy ending theorem. So Erdos called it this way. Why? Because in the end of the story, Szekeres and Esther Klein married. And it was a very happy marriage. And they lived 95 years, well, the whole life. And together they lived for 70 years. And they died within 1 hour each of other. So in any case, it's very curious, especially to me it is curious because you don't see in this theorem any Ramsey theorem. So they rediscovered, Erdos and Szekeres rediscovered Ramsey's theorem, and being nice people, they out of respect to the originator of this result started calling anything with this spirit Ramsey theory. And that's the origin of the term Ramsey theory. Anything which has the spirit, which I already described more than once, you have a highly organized structure, you finitely color it, one piece should be highly organized. And that's actually the first principle of Ramsey theory, okay? So there are three principles which I remember I was writing a survey and was philosophizing, and I formulated these three principles, and then it took some effort for me to convince some of my mathematical friends that these are really there. So the first one is definitely there. That's, I repeat, there is no disorder, that's how they call it for short, namely you take ordered structure, finitely color, one piece still is highly ordered. Okay? And there are many examples of such results. Now, application of Ramsey theorem. Let we can take them in 0, 1, measure of a n bigger than a bigger than 0 for all n. So I just take a sequence of measurable sets of measure bounded from below. So then there exist an k. Well, 1 and 2, such that measure of A and I intersection A and K is bigger or equal than for any epsilon, bigger than A square minus epsilon. How do we prove such theorem? So first of all, you should see the spirit of Ramsey's theorem around, because I took sequence AN. I'm interested in pairs AN, AM. And for all IK. And I want to get a subsequence so that any two pairwise, any two sets from subsequence are pairwise heavily intersecting. I hope it's clear that you cannot beat this. Is it clear? I'm trying to see if you are asleep or with me. So anyone wants to help me? Why this is the best possible? Thank you. Because if your sets are independent, in independent case, measure of AN AM is measure of AN, AM, of course, N not M. And this is general knowledge that there are independent sets, okay? And so for independent sets, you cannot get better than A square. And this is already more subtle exercise. So can you beat this epsilon? So no. So that's indeed about the best you can get. You still can ask additional questions of interest. You still can ask questions of interest. What can you say about NIs? Is there any interesting potential, either structure or size? That's much more delicate. We will not address it. This is an exercise. I will be meeting with you after the lunch. I will be glad to maybe give more hints about some of the exercises I gave you, but this one is actually useful, so maybe you want to think about it. Okay. Now, so back to principles of Ramsey theory. So yes, let's do it this way, just to summarize. So, and it's N is union of CI, and then, and this implies many things. So, one of CI is AP rich. Do you remember whose theorem is this? Well, I don't remember if I denoted, defined what is AP rich. Let's guess what is AP rich. Anyone? People, I'm trying to help you to awake, so that's why. What? Yes, thank you. AP rich means contains arbitrarily long arithmetic progression. It's a very suggestive term, right? AP, arithmetic progression. And now, whose theorem is this? Van der Waerden, thank you. So this is Van der Waerden. And then another theorem is that one of CI contains finite sums of an infinite sequence. Whose theorem is that? Hindman, thank you. So you do remember something from yesterday, good. So this is Hindman. And this implies Schur and implies and Hilbert's results. Okay, so these are two very basic, they're not the only ones, but they're definitely very basic things. One of them is about arithmetic structure of N. Which of them is about arithmetic structure of N? You can say both, but it's really only one. Which one is about arithmetic structure? It's Hindman. You have semigroup structure in N, and you imitate the semigroup structure by Hindman theorem as good as you are lucky to get. So it will be infinite sequence together with all possible finite sums. This is approximate semigroup, that's the best you can hope for, okay? Now, van der Waerden, while it deals, of course, with arithmetic progressions that in principle you define with the help of arithmetics in N, is, in my opinion, much stronger geometric structure, because van der Waerden is about equispaced points. It's about lattice property. Okay, so if you take this point of view, van der Waerden theorem is interesting because you can approach it from different points of view, and each of them may lead to different interesting, more general fact. So if you think about geometry, this is really getting, after finitely coloring a lattice, you get sublattice. If you approach it from number theoretical point of view, it's about progressions, they are given by Diophantine equations or systems of Diophantine equations, and you may want to ask which systems of Diophantine equations are partition regular, remember this term, partition regular, namely for any finite coloring, I still want solutions to these equations. For example, a single equation, x plus y equals z, is partition regular in the sense that if I finitely color integers, I always get the equation x plus y equals z. So if you want to take a point of view of equations related to van der Waerden theorem, then this equation is also partition regular, because that's about progressions of length 3, right? Are you awake? Okay. So this is about first principle, and we'll have many more results. So I want you to recognize this principle. You took a structure, finitely partitioned, you get in one piece imitating structures. They may be looked at as geometric objects or arithmetic objects or set theoretical objects. And now, next question, much more fundamental, is why this happens. Okay. And so the second principle, so this is first principle, and that's illustration. And I don't want to repeat it anymore, but what is second principle? And by the way, we are still doing combinatorics, but very soon I would like to move to ergodic theory. So the good point about all these results is that, maybe with the exception of Ramsey's theorem, they have natural ergodic formulations. So these are static results, but ergodic results give you dynamical reasons for them. We saw it yesterday with Hilbert's theorem, okay? And this is something which can be taken far away. Okay, so second principle, there exists a notion of largeness, which is responsible for Ramsey theoretical results. And this is very wide topic, very rich topic, and I want to start discussing it. You see, this second principle is intentionally a meta principle. So there are many notions of largeness. I want you really to adopt this point of view. So there are many potential notions of largeness which give you explanation of these results. So you can go, for example, to van der Waerden. So the most natural notion of largeness I formulated last time. So let me repeat it because it's relevant to van der Waerden. I think I can erase this. So let me. So D bar of E, my E is an N, is by definition lim sup of E intersection so theorem Szemeredi around 1975. If D bar of E is positive, then E is AP rich. So this is a totally fantastic theorem, total gem of mathematics. Has very hard proofs, many by today, and they all are non-trivial. And in order to, you see what we like in good mathematics, easy to formulate, hard to prove, and connects to many things. And it has it all, okay? So it has various formulations or leads to much more general results, and each new step needs new ideas. It definitely has very strong ergodic feel. I will tell you about this in a second, but it's also can be interpreted something related to graph theory. So this question actually was, Szemeredi's theorem is answer to question posed by Erdos and Szekeres. So answering question by Erdos and Szekeres. Oops, I'm not sure. Anyone knows how to write Turan? There should be some accent somewhere. There's no one here who would know. Huh? Like this? Like this? Okay, thank you. Erdos and Szekeres asked this question in '30s, and they wanted to better understand van der Waerden. And when they asked this question, the question which Szemeredi answered, they maybe didn't imagine how hard is the question. So eventually Erdos announced a prize for this, and Szemeredi, it's really a masterpiece of mathematics, very hard to read. You may want to try. Good luck. So But then, of course, Furstenberg came with a dynamical proof of this, which is not trivial, but it's now written in many books, including Furstenberg's book, including book by Waerden and Einsiedler. Einsiedler and Waerden have the proof there too, right, of Szemeredi. And it was extended because of ergodic underpinnings, was extended to much stronger results, which do not have today combinatorial proofs yet. And that's what is interesting. So there is constant competition between more conventional methods and dynamical methods. Dynamical methods bring you new results of very big strength, but they usually are not finitistic. And if by finitistic, I mean not just existence of constants, I mean estimates on these constants. And if you're interested in estimates on the constants, then it's very hard. So there is yet another proof of Szemeredi by Gowers, which is the best S for the estimates. Okay. Do I have to explain that this is has all the right to be called a density version of van der Waerden theorem? So results which invoke notion of largeness somehow by tradition coming from upper density are called in combinatorics density versions, okay? So as they say, for any Ramsey theoretical result, you can ask but not always get density version. And let's discuss this. So for example, Ramsey's theorem. Is there a chance for density version? What would be density version in Ramsey's theorem? Before we go to Ramsey, maybe let's go to Schur for fun of it. So Schur theorem is about partition regularity of such triples. We discussed it yesterday. Okay? Can you suggest a notion of largeness which would explain Schur theorem? By the way, what Szemeredi theorem does, it tells you that for any finite coloring, any large, not just one, but any piece of, with positive upper density would be good. Ideally, we would like to have the same for Schur. Anyone wants to suggest notion of largeness which would help me with Schur? Well, you immediately should first of all see that upper density is useless for Schur, or at least it looks as not helpful, right? Why? Oh, you don't know. How about odd numbers? People awake. Odd numbers, is it large set? It is. Can you solve Schur equation in odd numbers? Somebody said yes. So here we face, and that's, you remember yesterday I suggested some, at least for us, local terminology about affine configurations and projective configurations. So Szemeredi theorem and van der Waerden, they deal with projective configurations because shifted progression is as good progression from that point of view. But Schur theorem is something which is not stable under shifts. It's stable only under dilations, okay? That's why it's projective result, not affine result. And Schur theorem, being projective, not affine, doesn't allow you to use D-bar, because at least not immediately, not obviously, since odd numbers is a set of density 1/2, and there is no Schur theorem there. So this is interesting. We don't see at this stage, I didn't introduce any notional largeness which would explain Schur. And if we cannot explain Schur, we cannot explain Hindman, because Hindman is far-reaching extension of Schur and is also as projective as Schur, okay? On the other hand, we did yesterday provide the density version of Hilbert theorem. This was the proof we gave. It was actually easy proof, in a way much easier than original Hilbert's proof and of much stronger result. So we see that affine configurations allow to easier invent notions of largeness. But projective, you have to find something else, and I will introduce it, but maybe not today. Okay? I can, just to scare you a little bit, I can tell you that the explanation comes or maybe one of the best notions of largeness comes from topological algebra and stone check compactifications. This is really from totally different planet, okay? But this is very effective. And in my opinion, there are many new results waiting to be proved by using technology coming from topological algebra and stone check compactification, so we'll talk about this maybe tomorrow. All right, so let me entertain you with one more theorem, so exercise for any finite coloring one of CIs is GP rich. Did we guess what is GP rich? Geometric progressions. Thank you. Is it obvious that one of the colors is GP rich? If not, you have to awake. I don't know, maybe it's we should start tomorrow at 10 instead of 9. No, anyone? Help me.
Log?
Log in integers. No. Great.
Oh, I log.
And moreover, instead of log, I would take E, but that's okay. But maybe that there is something to what you say if you just say it better. So, anyone?
You take 2, 4, 8, and then take log.
Thank you. That's anti-log. So, indeed, coloring of N induces coloring of 2 to the N. This is subset of N, so we colored N. We colored, of course, this pretty slim subset of N. And this coloring itself induces coloring of N's. But for any colorings of N's, by van der Waerden, you have arithmetic progression. That's why you will get 2 to N0, 2 to N0 plus D, 2 to N0 plus 2D, and so on. And that's already geometric progression. Are we comfortable with all that? But so what did we learn? So thank you, Ariel. Now start taking notes. So it seems that this is pretty cheap, right? So there are so many cyclic subgroups in N. Each of them will give you geometric progressions. So there are plenty. And that leads us to third principle. And this actually will deserve prolonged discussion, so let me formulate the third principle and then we will start discussing it. So the right question perhaps is not getting geometric progressions, because as you see, it's rather cheap. But the right question maybe is to try to understand if it is true that there are many geometric progressions. Other progressions coming not necessarily from cyclic groups. What can you say about notions not of largeness, but let's call it super-largeness? Those notions which would attempt to evaluate the massivity, the abundance of good configurations, okay? So I will formulate it as a third principle, and then we'll start asking this question in different situations. So third principle. Good configurations are abundant. When I say good, I mean those which you are looking for and you will find in one color or maybe in any large set. So I don't want to start defining good. I think it's clear from the discussion. Now, I would like to define abundant because that's important. But there are too many possibilities here, and that's why it's again. So, like with the second principle, you have freedom of looking for different notions of largeness, and some of these notions are unexpected, and some of them are better than others. And in second, in third principle, you also have enormous freedom inventing notions of, I call sometimes these notions conullness, because they're so super large. You expect them, for example, to have filter property. We'll get there in a moment, okay? So we have now three principles. Now we'll be discussing each of them and inventing new results. So maybe now it's about time to awake. Okay, so just to challenge you here, so this was easy exercise. And then another exercise for any finite coloring of N, coloring N union CI, one of CI is both AP rich and GP rich. Okay, can you help me here? First of all, it's true. That's a priori not that clear. You see, one color will be AP rich, another color will be GP rich. To have this all in the same color, that's good, but and that supports first principle pretty well. But why? Well, so that remains an exercise, but this one I would like to solve together. So maybe we'll come back to it. But in any case, take my word that one cell of partition is actually, so let me formulate something even more general, maybe not now, but in principle, there are two structures in N. It's multiplicative structure, it's additive structure. And if for any finite coloring you find in one color configurations from both structures, or maybe even mixed creatures, I call them sometimes geoarithmetic progressions, then it really suggests that Szemeredi theorem, while it's beautiful and so strong, does not fully address the question about density version. For example, here, if this is true, so we need an example, wait a second. So first of all, I almost forgot. So let's take this result, the first one. What would be a potential density theorem of that kind? Forget about mixed APs and GPs. Let's take only GPs. What notion of largeness is behind that? So again, since the only notion of largeness so far that we have is this one, so we should maybe discuss if this one works. No, that's a question to you. So is notion of upper density good for density version of GP version of Szemeredi, of van der Waerden? So van der Waerden has AP version, has GP version, they are connected. You may want to see if from GP version, by taking log of whatever you are lucky to get, if from GP version you can get AP version. You see, we got GP from AP. Can you go back? Maybe. In any case, what is density version of GP van der Waerden? So we should scrutinize the notion of upper density. We already noticed that upper density is not good for sure. Is it good for GP? People say no. Why?
Numbers that are free of squares have
what?
Numbers that are free of squares.
Very good. That's what I expected you to say. Yes, so if you take square-free numbers, so if S is square-free numbers, then density of S is 6 over pi square. But surely S is not GP rich, right? Is it totally clear? Square-free numbers, is it clear what are square-free numbers? That's okay if you don't know, I will tell you, but you have to communicate, otherwise it will be one-way discussion. People who would like to have definition of square-free numbers, can you raise your hand? Only one. Thank you. Two. Two is enough. I will give you definition. And so these are all numbers written in the form P1, PI1, C1, PI2, C2, PIK, CK, where CIs are 1. Okay? So numbers which you can write only by using first powers of primes. So any number is product of primes, and we take only very, you would think, thin subset of all numbers, those which have only first power. That's why square free. No power can be two or more. Okay, so it's very suggestive, square free. This is one of enormously important sets, one of my favorite sets in mathematics. It will be in December, a conference related to partly to Möbius function and Cernak's conjecture. Yesterday it was actually defined. I don't know. In talk of Riva, square free numbers were mentioned already then because Möbius function was mentioned then, and this is very important set. So it's good to know a little bit about this set. So square free numbers surely don't have progressions, geometric progressions. And this is a pretty large set. For students who only start learning number theory, it comes as a surprise that this set, which uses only first powers of primes, is so large. That's counterintuitive for many people. The explanation, of course, is that we measure the set additively while it is defined multiplicatively. And it is the coexistence of additive and multiplicative structures which is very mysterious and very interesting. And the rule of thumb is that additive multiplicative structures are in a way independent, and there are many results, more advanced than today's topics, which I could mention, which confirm that, okay? And so you start with square free numbers to start attempting getting some feelings about that, okay? So we have open question now. What is density version of this theorem? And we don't see candidate, at least at this stage. Okay? So now what we can do, the rest of morning talk, we can start discussing all these principles in the form of formulating results, which would be guesses about what is actually true. But first I want to start a little bit, at least, to introduce ergodic theory. So let us go back to Poincaré recurrence. So you remember Poincaré recurrence was good for us in order to prove combinatorial version. Or with the help of combinatorial version of Poincaré recurrence, we got pretty easy proof of and of stronger version of Hilbert theorem, right? So Poincaré recurrence should be scrutinized and maybe improved, and then you can get who knows what else. So let me do that. Any questions so far? So we still want to maybe practice to do some examples of third principle. That's what I will be trying to do right now. So what kinds of notions of massivity we can introduce? We already see that we are lacking new notions of largeness, that's for sure. If we believe, by the way, it's conditional matter. If you believe in these principles, and I suggest you will, because that's only how you will guess new theorems, okay? So if you believe in principle one, you can guess theorems. If you believe in principle two, you can introduce new notions of largeness and get new theorems of stronger nature. And if you believe in principle three, then it's even better. So that's what we are going to do right now. And let us start maybe with Poincaré recurrence. Because, no, there is one more theorem I want to formulate, which is also interesting. And summary of this discussion is that we are lacking notions of largeness, which would help us with Schur and Hindman. We are lacking notion of largeness, which would help us with GP version of van der Waerden. So this is already something which would be interesting to discover and discuss, all right? Okay, so let me formulate, and in order not to erase, let me try to formulate it here. beautiful result by another Hungarian mathematician, Sarkozy. I think it is like this. All right, Sarkozy. If density of E is positive, then E minus E contains a perfect square. It's clear what it is? So E minus E is the set of all differences, X minus Y, X and Y from E, and it contains perfect square. So it means that you can solve equation x minus y equal n square, where x and y are in E, and n is some integer. That's amazing theorem, so I want to discuss it. By the way, there is one more principle which I will start illustrating at some stage, and that's amazing thing itself. Take any two results from Ramsey theory, there is usually common generalization. I say, take any two results of Ramsey theory, I don't know, Sarkozy and Szemeredi, then it is a common generalization. You can find it and prove it and become famous. And we'll demonstrate it too. But I want to discuss a little bit this result because it's, people are quoting von der Waerden theorem so often that you stop being, you know, surprised. So von der Waerden seems to be totally natural, right? You have lattice structure, in one piece you still have lattice. So that's, we already adopted. You see, usually you are surprised only first time, but then after hearing it many times, you're already not surprised. But if you see Sarkozy theorem first time today, it should be very surprising. By the way, for my statistics, and hoping that you are awake, who never saw Sarkozy theorem before? Can you raise your hand? Great, they are awake. Okay, so let us discuss it. That's an amazing theorem. By the way, it came as a solution or answer to conjecture by Lovas. And Lovas arrived at this conjecture, they say, from graph theory. And it's amazing. I would like to understand how in the world he arrived at this conjecture. Today we understand plenty about, I know about three or four proofs of Sarkozy theorem, and they, of course, are not graph theoretical. I say, of course, because that's not my science. But the conjecture came from graph theory, and it would be interesting to understand why and how. But the result is so surprising because E is large set, all right, E is of positive density. But should it be so large that its differences contain small, intersect small sets? Because that's what it is, right? So this means that E minus E intersection and squares is non-empty. But that's strange. So E minus E seems now, because of this at least, seems to be so huge that it intersects small sets. And now you can ask many questions. Which small sets it intersects? Why? What is behind it? And I want you also to see this new kind of questions as connected to third principle. It's you have to a little bit tweak your imagination to connect it to third principle, but if differences are good configurations, then differences are so abundant that they intersect squares. And that's amazing. And of course you should ask, and let's try to play with this a little bit. You know, since I know that I will have a little bit more time afternoon, I can allow myself to go slower. So what other sets? Can you suggest any other sets? Which, just for fun of it, right? So if you see that squares are good, shouldn't you think of some other sets, just at least randomly in primes? Good try, but but let me ask you, if my E is 4n, do you expect the set of differences to intersect primes? And you understand why I took 4n and not 2n? Okay, so so primes will fall. What? Thank you. This was planted question. Thank you. So we can ask now. Let's ask. So Marius told me I should not use manual labor here. So I will go this way. And now I will go this way. No, I think I want, actually I want to use this board first. So, and now I will use that one. Okay, so we are discussing the most primitive thing. So D of E is positive. And so want to ask if E minus E contains square, we know. What else it could contain? Does it contain n square plus 1 for some other n? So let it be m. You know, to extend your question, how about k square minus 1? How about prime, but we killed it already? So how about more? Any polynomial would, after we discuss this, we can start guessing it. So let's finish this discussion first, because we don't know what are the answers. You want to improve your question about primes? So I will help you. You see, primes is the ultimate object of studies in number theory. That goes without saying. But for ergodic theoretic point of view, or from combinatorial point of view, actually much more interesting set is primes minus 1, or primes plus 1. And no other shift of primes is as good as these two sets. Okay, and so here is an example of this. So there exists always prime P such that E minus E contains prime minus 1. And there exists always prime Q such that E minus E contains Q plus 1. So that's non-trivial. By the way, it was already Sarkozy who proved it as well. Sarkozy's methods were, you know, pure analytic number theory with pretty non-trivial estimates of trigonometric sums, and his results being method of trigonometric sums give some estimates. So from that point of view, his results are very strong. But his results are not easy, his methods are not easy to use to, the moment you modify a little bit some of these questions. For example, his methods already don't easily give, maybe not give at all. So fact, equation x minus y equal z square is partition regular. Is it clear that this is different from Sarkozy theorem? Sarkozy theorem tells you if set is large, the differences contain square. Differences come from the set. Squares not necessarily come from the set. Okay? If I take E to be numbers of the form, I don't know, 3n plus 2, then of course, by Sarkozy theorem, this contains a square, but the square cannot belong to E. Is it clear? I don't see it by your faces. So If you take squares of integers, they can be either of the form 3n or 3n plus 1. They never can be of form 3n plus 2. So when you get a square in this set, it cannot come from set itself, for that simple reason. So by the way, you see that we sometimes, if we have some ambition to generalize, we hit an obstruction, which is called often local obstruction. So in all this kind of mathematics, there is a subtle nuisance. This is local obstructions, namely things which work or do not work because of divisibility contradictions. And anyone who does elementary number theory knows that that's always part of the business. And that's exactly what happens here. So set E minus E may not contain a square from coming from itself for divisibility reasons and for those reasons alone. That's already a theorem. So I can now formulate more general result, characterizes maybe even polynomials which are good. But before that, let's go here. So I gave you some help, so I expect you to answer now this question. Pierre, you knew the answer when you asked the question. What? So let us ask this. So you see, we should start being careful. N square is good. That's Sarkozy. N square minus 1 is actually good. We'll see general theorem in a moment, which gives necessary and sufficient conditions. But N square plus 1 is, again, not good for Sarkozy theorem. And that's surprising, because you think that maybe you need zero constant term. Not really. So this is OK. And this is not. No, and what is counterexample for m squared plus 1?
Just the same.
Same example, right? OK. So so I think we answered some of these questions. I'm surprised no one asked about 2 to the power n. Each time I give talks with maybe less sleepy audience, so there is always somebody who would ask a question about 2 to the n. No one wants to ask this question? If you don't ask, I will not answer it. Okay. So now I want to start formulating so I hope from now on we remember what is Sarkozy theorem. It's a beautiful result. It's really mysterious in a way, and it leads, if properly treated, to far-reaching ergodic effects, which are of big interest, in my opinion, also in physics. So I will maybe get there very soon. So this is variation on Sarkozy, so it's interesting to know. And by the way, oh, before I erase it, okay, so let me come back. E minus E has n squared, and E minus E contains prime minus 1. And remember I told you that give me any two theorems in Ramsey theory and there is joint generalization. Do you want to suggest it now? After I keep, you know, forcing you to be inventive in positive way. So what would be joint generalization of these two results? For example, it's not necessarily joint generalization, but surely it's suggestive. Very good. So as a matter of fact, yes. And that's better. You suggested p squared minus 1, which is happens to be also true. But how do you prove that? That's already you need newer techniques. But and there is more than one technique, by the way. But when primes are involved, there is only less techniques. And when primes are involved, you need to use some results from number theory. And there are some of them which are more palatable than others, so I can explain if time will be there, and if you ask questions, I can tell you more about why primes minus 1 is good and 1 prime minus 1 square is good, okay? But you have to ask these questions, otherwise I will not answer. All right. So now I want uh, So this equation is interesting, right? So suddenly we have now nonlinear equations which are also partition regular. Before I erase, do you want to ask questions about this kind of equation? Because there is totally natural question to ask when you see this equation. Let me see if I can sort of induce you to ask a natural question when you see equation x minus y equals z square. No, no, we saw already that node. We saw that z cannot come from. No, this is a good question, but that one we already asked and answered. No, when you see an equation, you should ask about other equations. What is the totally natural next equation to ask question about? Thank you. It works, but so x plus y equals z square is not partition regular. So mystery is here, okay? So there are some Diophant, and that's in general true about number theory dealing with Diophantine equations. They all are beautiful, but some are more beautiful than others. And so x minus y equals z square is solvable, and x plus one y equals z square is not. And so general theory of systems of linear equations, which would be generalization of van der Waerden and Schur simultaneously. Okay, keep this in mind. I keep returning to this. You have Schur equation, partition regular. You have van der Waerden theorem, partition regular. Is there a joint generalization of these two results? In which language you would formulate it? One possibility is to consider more generally systems of linear equations with integer coefficients and try to find criteria for them to be partition regular. Okay? And this question was answered in fullness by Rado in '30s. So there is necessary and sufficient theorem about systems of linear equations which are partition regular. But the moment you go to nonlinear equations, and they are much more interesting, then it's a jungle. Some are true, some are not. There are classes by now which we know are true. There are easy, or sometimes less easy, counterexamples. It's mystery, and it's clear why it is mystery, because polynomial Diophantine equations include Fermat's theorem. Okay, so it cannot be easy topic. Okay, yeah, so of course, to check if you are awake or not, I could ask if you think that this is partition regular equation, but I don't, because I think you're awake by now. Why should? No, reaction is pretty mild. So is it is it clear that this is not partition regular equation? Okay. Okay, so we all know what is Poincaré recurrence, and now I want to spend some time extending, improving Poincaré recurrence, and maybe it will, if we do it well, maybe we can even explain or start explaining Sarkozy by Poincaré recurrence or by version of it. Okay, so classical Poincaré recurrence for any x b mu t, for any a measure of a positive, the set of n which measure of a t and a positive is infinite. This was the proof we gave, so you find n for which it happens, and then it's a little exercise to show that you can find even bigger n for which it will happen. So it means that typical point, this was another exercise, but I hope you can do it. Typical point of your set will come back infinitely many times. That's the corollary which Poincaré was interested in. And this is a pretty mild version of what you would want to call stability of solar system. Because if you come back after too many billion of years, maybe you're not happy. So you should come with regularity and more often, okay? So that's what we should start checking. So what can we say? What else can we say about the set N for which mu of A, T minus N A is positive? And that's a fundamental question, because that's so basic thing in celestial mechanics that it would be interesting to answer it. And it was Hinchin. So Hinchin's recurrence theorem. So I will take it as a standing assumption, and I will stop writing it. I hope it will be clear that we assume that you have any probability space and measure preserving transformation in any large set. And so he says that N for which mu of A, T minus N A bigger than mu of A square minus epsilon is syndetic. So this is yet another notion of largeness, which I will introduce now. So syndetic IE has bounded gaps. Is it clear, or I should define it even more formally? So set is called syndetic if its complement doesn't have too long intervals. In other words, so syndetic means that finitely many shifts cover N or Z. Okay, so you take your set. If it is syndetic, you shifted it a few times, just shift to the left if you are in N. And you got everything. Syndetic sets were introduced into analytic number theory and analytic mathematics, it seems, by Bohr, when he introduced almost periodic functions. This is a deep and very rich topic, which today is hardly studied anywhere. So how many of you know what is almost periodic function? Can you raise your hand? Who doesn't know what is almost periodic function? And so it's not, these sets are not complementary, so. Okay, so that's a separate topic, very interesting topic, we may touch on it. Almost periodicity is deep analytic notion, but and of big importance to mechanics and physics, but ergodically speaking, it's actually at the very bottom of complexity. It is totally described by rotations on compact abelian groups, which ergodic theoretically is one of the simplest possible systems. And that already takes care of all almost periodicity in the world. It doesn't mean that it takes care successfully, because there are questions about Fourier analysis of almost periodic functions, which are very deep, but it explains how they come about. If you will remind me about this, we can talk more about almost periodicity. But back to this, question there? Question. So you see, this is an improvement of Poincaré in every possible way you think, right? So you get, I hope it's clear, optimal intersection size, because if you're in Bernoulli system, what is called Bernoulli systems, which come from coin tossing, so you have independence of images, then you cannot get better than mu of a square. And second, it gives you very strong, good notion of largeness, that syndeticity. So we should add syndetic to notions of largeness. It's maybe not as good as upper density, we can explain why, but I can give you already one exercise right away. And I want to solve it with you right away. Oops, time is running. So, exercise. If E is syndetic, then E is AP rich. Is it clear why? You should give me two solutions right now. After, if you were awake today, you should offer two solutions. Thank you. This was the first solution I was expecting. It is arguably quite an overkill. But I hope it's also clear, and that should be clear, that if set is syndetic, then it has positive upper density. Moreover, if you need always has positive density, positive upper. Right? So syndetic sets, you know, if finitely many shifts cover everything, then suppose you needed five shifts, then the density of your set should be at least 1/5. Okay? So this was overkill. Can you derive this result from van der Waerden? You should use something, so maybe van der Waerden is appropriate strength of tools. Yes, thank you. So you take E, you take those finitely many shifts which cover everything, and this will be finite coloring or finite partition. In disregard if they intersect, we can deal with this, okay? So morally, you arrive at finite partition of integers by just taking the shifts of E. One of those shifts should contain arithmetic progressions by van der Waerden. Arithmetic progressions are shift invariant configurations. Hence, E contains van der Waerden, AP rich sets. That's it. Okay. So that's easy. But of course, syndeticity is not so good notion of largeness, because it is not partition regular. So when you deal with notions of largeness, you really want large sets to be partition regular. You took large set, finitely colored it, one piece should be still large. This is the case with infinite sets. This is the case with sets of positive upper density. But this is not the case with syndetic sets. I hope it's totally clear. If you take syndetic set and finitely color it, neither piece has to be syndetic. Is that clear? Is it? No. So here is a proof. N is syndetic set, right? N is syndetic set. And so here is the coloring in two colors, which shows to you that you can color and neither piece will be syndetic. And I will show it this way. So is it clear or I have to say any more? You split your set into intermittently longer and longer pieces. And neither of them can be syndetic, because you create arbitrarily large gaps in both of them, right? This example also shows something counterintuitive for some of you who studied first time. So there exists A in N or E, such that density of E equal density of E complement equal 1. Is it clear from this example? If you tweak it, it is clear. Clear? I can go as long as I want with each of those two intermittent portions. And I will take each of them as long as I need to get as close as I want to one, and then I forget about this and go for the other portion much, much longer time, and we'll get the other, the complement, and so on. So you can pack large sets if D bar positive is your notion of largeness, and they will be disjoint and still of density 1. This is something to somehow adopt to your intuition. It's not immediately intuitive, okay? You would not have this example with natural density, when it is just D of A existing, but D bar, here is this. Okay, so I will now formulate. So first of all, I wanted to prove it to you. Some things have to be proved. This theorem turns out to be still not the final step here. So this is, at least because of syndetic being not partition regular, you expect n's which do it to be massive. And there is another theorem, so theorem, ergodic version of Sarkozy due to Furstenberg. And it says that those n, that this is positive, contains n square. So let's formulate it differently. So there exists n, so that mu of A intersection T minus N square A is positive. Now, if you will somehow press me, I will be able to prove to you that this is equivalent to Sarkozy. This is really same theorem in ergodic disguise. And ergodic theorem is even more interesting, because ergodic theorem tells you that you take a typical point in your set, and after quadratic number of seconds, it comes back. And if you're interested in those times, so you're a physicist, and you're interested in getting back to your set, and you're interested in knowing along which times you can measure it, if it is only quadratic return times that you care about, then you have plenty of free time. You can do other things in your lab, or you can go and get a degree in law in your spare time. So, and we didn't finish, by the way, the story. So which other polynomials are good? You didn't ask, I didn't tell you, but there is a if and only if condition for polynomials. So this is the same as Sarkozy. The fact that you are coming back along quadratic times and along polynomial times for at least good enough polynomials, that's from physics point of view, I think, totally amazing. So let me, I still have 3 minutes, let me formulate ergodic theorem. You understand, I was doing Ramsey theory because it's great ideological background, but I really want to sell to you the strength of ergodic methods and ergodic approaches. And so I'm itching to go back to ergodic theory. And since you don't ask questions, I may never go to ergodic theory because I will be afraid that it will be maybe too non-interesting. But at least let us formulate ergodic theorem and I will formulate it in a this is explanation of this. So let us look at this for a moment. Ergodic theorem deals with averages. So in principle, you can take various averages of this kind, and you expect this to go to integral of f d mu as n goes to infinity, and in different modes, either in norm or almost everywhere. And this all happens if T is ergodic. If T is ergodic. So for physics reasons, you're interested in getting time averages equal to space averages. Is that clear? That's the main theme in theory of uniform distribution, in ergodic theory, and in certain areas of number theory. Time averages equals space averages. You measure every second and average, that's time. This is space average. If space would be not normalized, I would have to modify it. But the correct limit that time average equals space average, it's only when T is ergodic. For combinatorial purposes, you want general results, when you don't assume that T is ergodic and still have non-trivial output. And that's, from that point of view, that's exactly what Hinchin proved. So the fact that you can take uniform averages, this relates to notion of well distribution in number theory. And the fact that it's there, it's corollary of von Neumann's ergodic theorem. The fact that it's n minus m is totally not surprising when it comes to correlations. Here, by the way, n minus m is not true if you take almost everywhere. So it's subtle, it becomes subtle, and if you don't have experience with this, be careful, okay? So sometimes you can take only 1 over n if you're interested in pointwise. When you're interested in norm, say L2 norm, then suddenly you can take moving averages. From ergodic point of view, that's what is much better. So you don't care about the subtlety of almost everywhere because it's really not far away from norm convergence. Okay, for subsequence, it will be almost everywhere. That's not so important. But the fact that you can take n minus m is of huge importance. And let us see why getting n minus m here, as I say, that's part of norm convergence business. And getting this limit, that's already some game, but it's true. For those of you who know a little bit of ergodic theory, this would be correct result if T is ergodic, and if you use ergodic decomposition, you should use some convexity and get it. That's overkill, but still, that's the reason, okay? But I want, and that's the last thing I want. So I want you to understand, last thing before the break, I want to understand together with you why this implies Hinchin. That's the last thing we want to do. Now, can you explain to me why this result? That's what Hinchin proved. So he really did much more. He proved much stronger result. That's his ergodic theorem. But it is from this ergodic theorem which Hinchin's recurrence theorem follows. And do we see why? Everything is on the blackboard. Very good. So let me then repeat what you said. What's your name?
Rodolfo.
Rodolfo, thank you. You are a good helper today. So hear what Rodolfo says. If this is the limit, what does it mean? It means that if you get long enough interval over which you average, you will get in this neighborhood. So take long enough interval so that it's epsilon close to this, no matter where is your interval. So take anywhere your interval, over this interval the averages are big, and these are averages of numbers between 0 and 1. So at least one of them will be that big, and your interval is anywhere, so that proves syndeticity. And it really shows that there is something much stronger about this, that is here. So I want you to now analyze it and to realize that this result is actually way stronger. That's maybe too big luck. For results about recurrence, we would be happy with this. But this gives actually much more. And that explains Hinchin phenomenon. Hinchin phenomenon is good as improvement on Poincaré, but Hinchin phenomenon doesn't explain that. Syndetic set doesn't have to contain squares. So the question which we can ask now, and we will answer it next time we meet, is there a common generalization of this, or this, say, this, and this? If you go along squares, are you promised to get large intersections? Are you promised to get intersections along syndetic sets? If so, what ergodic results are behind it? Can it be taken care of by Cesaro averages? Not easily. So there are many things here. So the moment you start asking questions, and they are in philosophic line of third principle, really. You want large intersections along large sets of times. That's about this. When you interpret it back to combinatorics, if you take my word that this is the same as Sharkozy, you will see that it also leads to serious improvements of Sharkozy. That's all for the first meeting of today. Thank you.